microphone.
Thank you. Thank you. We've got the microphone sorted now. So good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Mr. Cameron is joining us remotely this morning. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 3 in private? Thank you. Our second agenda item is the crisis in Ukraine, and it will be one of two evidence sessions this morning. The first one, welcome to committee, Yevhen Mankovsky, who is the Consul General for the Ukraine Consulate in Edinburgh. This is your first time in public speaking with us. I know you've spoken with my colleagues before today, and I think I speak for the whole committee in sending our wishes and solidarity to the Ukrainian people at this time, and could invite you please to make an opening statement.
Thank you so much. First of all, good morning to all of you. This time we are in open session, so maybe this time I'll be a little bit nervous and I'll be more polite and diplomatic. It is a big honor for me to visit the session of the committee again. And I really appreciate for the invitation and you taking the time to do this again. A lot has changed after my previous visit in Ukraine, in Scotland, with temporarily displaced Ukrainians. And first of all, I would like to start off by saying how much your support means to all of us. It is already more than 100 days when Russian full-scale invasion in Ukraine has begun. More than 100 days, the time has stood still for all Ukrainians throughout the world. And still, our troops defending our country, they are doing their best. And thanks to the support of the whole democratic world, we are defending our country. We are much appreciate for all that Scottish and UK governments are doing for people in Ukraine and for people who are temporarily displaced, who are temporarily came directly to Scotland, to the United Kingdom. All of them touched when they see Ukrainian national colors through over the Scotland, the building of the Scottish government, the Kelpies, the bridges in Inverness. So everywhere Ukrainian colors, and that's something that they need nowadays. So they see that we are not alone, that whole world supports us and the whole world is staying with us. Now maybe I will stop here to give and I will be happy, more than happy, to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mankovsky. One of the concerns for us is the safeguarding and safe passage and support for refugees who come here. I was a bit worried to see a Facebook advert, basically from probably a well-meaning source, but where a placement had broken down and people actually going out on Facebook and saying we need help. But from speaking with the minister, I know that the Scottish Government's absolutely adamant that anyone here can seek support either through the hubs or through the local authorities, and they will be given support under the super sponsor scheme. So is there anything that the Scottish Government or local authorities or we could be doing to emphasise to Ukrainians that the support is here and they don't need to do something that was potentially put them or a family member in danger as a vulnerable person? Just to get that message across that the support is here and where to go to get it.
Thank you for your question. So, first of all, they are not refugees. They are temporarily displaced Ukrainians. Yeah, it's just a small clarification because to become a refugee, you can apply for this status in the nearest border country. So it's in our case, it's Poland or Slovakia, Hungary, Moldova, Romania. They're already here, so they are receiving here temporary protection status, and we are hoping and we will want this that mostly of them will go back to Ukraine. Regarding your question about safeguarding, so People receive here all support what they need. So when they're arriving to Scotland, there are welcome hubs in Edinburgh Airport, in Glasgow Airport, welcome hub on 249 High Street in Edinburgh. So they are receiving support, they are receiving information. They are when they arrive for the airport, they are temporarily stay in hotels when Scottish government is looking for a sponsor for them or accommodation for them. But at the same time, I need to mention that a lot of people are asking that, for example, those one who are staying in hotels, they're asking that it will be very useful for them if some representatives from welcome hubs can visit them once per week and just update them with information. For example, that we are looking for accommodation, you can receive some benefits there, or if you need something, just hear the telephone numbers or contact details, please don't hesitate to give us a call. Something like this will be very useful for them, because it's not cheap to take a ride from hotels or from temporary accommodation to the welcome hub. And if they need some information or some updates, so they need to take a ride there and go back to their accommodation. At the same time, we, after the full-scale invasion have begun, so we have launched some type of also welcome hub. It's welcome hub by our community here in our community center in Edinburgh on 14 Royal Terrace. So all Ukrainians who are coming to Edinburgh, they can receive all support also there. They can receive all necessary stuff, supplies, donations, food, clothes, information, everything there. So if they need it, they just can follow us on Facebook. They can follow the websites, so, and they can see all updates, all information when there are sessions in the club, when they can visit, when they can receive all necessary information. We are doing usually this on Tuesdays, on Thursdays. Especially on Thursdays, it's very useful because we have in the club drop-in sessions with Scottish government, Home Office, PWP, and so on and so on. So all local authorities, all local governments, and they're just coming, visiting us, and they're helping people, because it's very, very useful, and we are hoping that it will continue more in June and July until September, yeah, because we really need this. It's very, very useful for them nowadays. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from the committee, and could invite first Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks very much for joining us again this morning. We know that you're exceptionally busy with dealing with casework and supporting people. The last time you came to committee, we talked about Ukrainian seasonal workers that are here. And I think at the time, just the details of the Ukrainian extension scheme were just coming out. I wanted to get your thoughts on how that scheme has worked. Have people been able to apply for the scheme? Have they got their visa extensions? Have there been any particular forms of advice and support that people still need?
Thank you for your question. So, yes, as far as we know, all of us, that when the war started on 21st of February, and when the schemes, the UK schemes visas have been launched, it was family scheme and sponsor scheme. All seasonal workers visas tier 5, so all their visas have been automatically extended till the end of this year, till the 31st of December 2022, and they don't need to do anything. They just was waiting when the representatives of Home Office will get in touch with their with the farmers, and they will clarify all details. So seasonal workers just knew that their visas have been extended, but now it's one more scheme visa. It's extensional scheme, so they can apply for this visa, and I can tell that it works. It's useful because Just a few days ago, we've made the power of attorney for a couple of seasonal workers, mother and father. We've made the power of attorney for them that grandmother can bring the kids from Ukraine abroad to UK. So as far as I understood to myself, that parents have applied for extensional scheme visa, and they can and their kid can be applied for example, super sponsor scheme visa, as Scottish government will be a sponsor, and then parents are going and to Poland or to Hungary, Slovakia, Moldova, Romania, and they pick up kids and they bring in kids here to UK, also to Scotland. So it works, as we see, but I can tell you in how good it is, because I didn't see a lot of cases of it, but just a few days ago I've seen it, and people were really happy that they have received their BRP cards, so now they can stay for in UK for 3 years, they can find a new job or something like this, and they can bring their kids. That's the most important, that they can bring their kids here in a safe place. Thank you.
And are you in contact with employers, with those who are employing seasonal workers? Are there any issues there in terms of accommodation, particularly in terms of bringing families over, whether accommodation is suitable? Has there been any issues around finding suitable accommodation for extended families?
Unfortunately, I didn't speak to any of farmers, so... because there was no occasions to speak to them, because everything's fine. They're staying on farms, they're living there, or if they have already received their BRP cards, they can apply for another job, they can change it. But for those who don't want to do this, they're living on farms, they are doing their job, they're still seasonal workers, and they're happy because they're doing their job. They're still doing what they can do and why they came to UK, to Scotland.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Allen.
Thank you. On the same point, just really to emphasise, thank you, firstly, for being here again, Consul General, but to emphasise that this committee has written to the UK government about some of these points about seasonal workers. So we're very sympathetic to them being on the visa scheme and being processed as quickly as possible. I just wanted to ask you on a completely different subject in that case about what more you feel Scotland can do, civic society, the Parliament can do to continue to keep the suffering of the Ukrainian people in the public imagination and to make sure that that attention doesn't go away.
Thank you for your question. So, first of all, I need to mention that you have already done a lot. It's Scottish government has done, and Scottish Parliament has already done a lot, really, and we are much appreciated for this, for all this support. But at the same time, there is always this small but. Yeah. There are some cases where we still need support, and maybe first of all, it's English classes for people, because for adults, for kids, that's very important, really. Not all of Ukrainians can speak English fluently, but still a lot of Ukrainians arriving here who don't speak English, absolutely don't speak English. So they need these classes, really. And another one, it's nurseries, unfortunately, but it's a very big problem, because mostly of those who are coming here, it is moms with kids. And a lot of kids who are under age of 5, so or even under or under age of 3. So when your kid is already 3, he can attend, or he or she can attend the nursery for free. So you can receive some benefits and some hours, free hours in the nursery. But if you're under age of 3, so you only need to pay. And unfortunately, there are it's not cheap to pay for nursery. And so these moms just don't know what they can do in this case, because they really need this support, they really need this help, because they want to apply for a job, but they can do this because their kids just 1.5, 2, 2.5, and they can't apply for nursery because it's really expensive for them. So maybe this that is very, very useful for us. That's, we have resolved all problems, all issues which we have, but nursery is still a big question for all of us, and especially for these moms who came to Scotland and to UK with kids. So thank you.
And on a completely different subject again, Consul General, I know that everyone is keen to make sure that that Scotland and the UK play their role in isolating the aggressor in this war economically. And I just wonder if you can say a bit about your observations about that and what we can all do to ensure that that Russia continues to be isolated economically.
Yes, so you are absolutely right that the whole world is stopping their business in Russia. As far as I know, it's already 1,537 companies have pulled out or stopped business in Russia, and we are asking the whole world and the businesses in the whole world just pull out of Russia and stop trade with aggressor, because that's your popularity, that's your business, and you will receive more profit if you will stop it there, and you will open new markets in the world. But we still need to show them that if you're going to do such things in 21st century, such invasions, such wars, so you can be a part of democratic world. So that's why we are asking the whole world stop of pull out of Russian market and stop trading with them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. It's also good to see you. It's to follow up the questions about support from the local community. I've visited the Ukrainian support network, and it is really impressive just to see what they're doing on the ground in terms of food, advice, even things like clothes, because of course so many people have come with just one small bag. So it's just rebooting all their lives. What really struck me was meeting two psychologists who've just been able to start supporting people. So it was that question about what support people are getting once they arrive, not just from the Ukrainian community, but in Edinburgh, which is clearly very strong, but in other parts of Scotland. Are there networks that people are able to tap into, or is it mostly kind of Edinburgh and Glasgow?
So, as far as I know, that mostly of people, mostly of Ukrainians are in Edinburgh, in Glasgow, in Aberdeen. Then we can take Highlands, Dumfries. So, but as far as I know, Edinburgh is already full with people, with Ukrainians. So they are trying to move them to Glasgow or to other parts of Scotland. So when they're arriving to Scotland, let's take example as Edinburgh. So when they're arriving to Edinburgh Airport, the Welcome Hub picked them up in Guggerburn House and RBS. So they are picked them up near the airport, and they're driving them to Guggerburn House. They are receiving there the welcome backpack with supplies. they can receive some benefits, money, but only part of them. And then they can apply. They can receive another one in Welcome Hub in City Centre, on High Street in Edinburgh. And then they, if they got sponsor already, so they can receive help to be moved to the sponsor. Or if they have applied for a sponsor, super sponsor scheme, as Scottish Government is a sponsor, they can they will be moved to the hotel, temporary hotel. So as I have already mentioned, what will be very useful for them if some of representatives of Welcome Hub will visit them in hotels once per week and just give them some updates What's the status of looking for sponsor for them? Maybe some updates, some news, what has changed, and so on and so on. So that's will be very useful for them. At the same time, there are maybe up to 500 Ukrainians who are in Scotland, and they're already staying in hotels more than 1 month or 2 months. So that's it's okay for those who are alone, who came by their own, because they're happy, they're in a safe place, they are in a hotel, they're receiving food, meals 3 times per day, so it's fine for them, absolutely. But for moms with kids, it's not very good. So we are trying to help them on our own way, on our own, but maybe if there will be more possibilities to to find social housing for them, especially for moms with 2 kids and more, that will be very useful, and that's what we need nowadays, really. And also, I just need to mention what I'm sorry, when I talked about nurseries, I forget about the schools, that there are some cases. It's not often, but some cases when, for example, school is just 5 minute walk from the accommodation, and when mom and kid is trying to apply for the school, and school rejects them because it's not in their area, and school in of their area is 30 minutes driving by car, so it's I'm just sorry to say this, but it's really difficult for them to do this, really, and because the school is just 5 minute walk. So if it's possible to make some exemptions for such type of families, or where they can apply for, where can they make their appeal or apply just to change to make extension for them, that will help them, really. And I think that's all, yeah, really. That's it. Thank you.
Yeah, that's really helpful feedback. I mean, the other thing I'd clocked was the challenge of people who are allocated a host and then it doesn't work out. And it's not because of a fault on either the family or the host. It's just people have different expectations, and there's a reality check once people settle in. I mean, it could be pets, allergies, food choices, could be anything that we would just take for granted. So that was one of the things I picked up when I met people trying to support Ukrainians, that there's a real nervousness, because I think my sense is that Ukrainians are so grateful to be able to come and get support. They don't really want to complain. So there's a real issue about how do we support those Ukrainians who've arrived. The first match doesn't work out. Particularly those who've got kids, to make sure that they get... We've got loads of hosts volunteering, but to make sure you get that match up.
Oh, it's a really difficult question.
But it's just the feedback I got that's one of the things we need to fix, maybe.
But at the same time, I need to mention that I just will tell you a short story, that when the Ukrainian family has came here, so it's... mom with 2 kids, they got the host already, the host family in Scotland, so they have met online, they have talked, everything's fine, they're happy, so, and this family was, got a transit in Amsterdam, in Netherlands, so they came to Scotland, they've met, everything's great, so they're happy, and this gentleman, the Scotsman, he start typing us an email, start calling to the consulate and just asking for help. We just need help for this Ukrainian family, just help us. And we didn't understand what's going on, what's happened, just in which case do you need our help. And after that, he's explained us that when this family, when we're crossing the border in Netherlands, in Amsterdam, at Amsterdam airport, the mom has lost some documents, and he just was trying to do his best. He was ready to do everything just to help this family to renew their documents. And I was asking which type of documents they have lost. So I have talked to mom, and she told me that they have lost their internal Ukrainian passports in Amsterdam. And I have mentioned to this gentleman that it's okay. They don't need this internal passport here in Scotland and the United Kingdom, so they will go back to Ukraine and they will renew it there. So currently they don't need it. Yes, it's you just can apply for in Amsterdam airport for lost and found. Maybe they will find it and they will send it here. But he was so keen on them, he was so interested in help them, that he just was ringing and ringing to the consulate. He was just typing in mail that help us, help us, help us. They lost their documents, and when we clarified which type of documents they have lost, so it's not just a big problem. When they will go back to Ukraine, they will renew it. But that was just something amazing, really, because Scottish people are so interested in this, and they're helping us so much, and they're supporting these families. That's all that we can say is just thank you. That's all. Just
thank you.
Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener. Just to follow up on Sarah Boyack's questioning, we've heard from those close to the super sponsor scheme there's some flaws. I'm keen to explore what your experience of the scheme is, and I know you've mentioned, for example, you know, 500 or more staying in hotels for 1 month or more. I just wondered if you have a sense of where the blockage is, and if there's anything, you know, that the Scottish Government could be doing, or COSLA, or individual local authorities. Do you have a sense of that at all?
First of all, it's approximate 500 people who throw over to Scotland who live in hotels more than 1 month. Unfortunately, we don't have direct numbers how many of them. When we are talking to people, we are talking to Ukraine. When I talk to Ukrainians who live in hotels, so there is we don't understand where is the problem. So of matching sponsor and the host family and Ukrainians who are already here, so they can do it on their they are trying to do their on their own, but still they can't do this. So Scottish Government is looking for a sponsor for them, but at the same time, we know, for example, some cases in Glasgow with social housing, but there are social housing in Glasgow, but it was decided that it should be destroyed because it's not okay anymore for live there. So, but at the same time, our community there have mentioned that they have spoken to the people who have been moved from this social housing just a few months ago, and they told like, yeah, this building just needs some renew, this accommodations just need some renew, just to some small repairs, but it's okay to live there. So, but at the same time, we have discussed this with Scottish Government, and yeah, they have mentioned that it's not suitable anymore for leave this social housing. So that's really very, as I mentioned, so social housing or accommodation is very important for moms with kids. It's very important for them, just because they will feel themselves more comfortable. And for those who are staying here alone, they're tired of hotels. Yes, they just want to have their own accommodation, their own property, or just to live maybe in a house or a flat with some sponsors. But at the same time, they're happy because they are in a safe place. And they have meal, they have support. So, but answering your question regarding where is the block, unfortunately, I can't tell you where is the block. But it's not. I'm not in charge on this because even people whom I talk every day, they don't understand where is the block. So they have applied. There are a lot of host families who has applied also to be a host family. So where is the block? Just to mention them, we don't understand. Maybe Because host families, for example, from Highlands, and the the Ukrainians have applied that they want to stay in Glasgow or in Edinburgh. So, but there are also lots of host families in Glasgow or Edinburgh. So that's why the block. So it's difficult to match them. So maybe in this case, because really, when people from Kyiv, for example, or Kharkiv, just came here and they have been moved to Highlands or to some countryside, they're really happy. They're really happy to be in Highlands. They were really happy to be in Highlands because it's amazing views, fresh air, just brilliant. They're happy. But after 2 weeks, they're started to be a little bit nervous and a little bit crazy because they get used to live in the big cities, such as Kyiv, and it's 4 million population in Kyiv, and just to live in Highlands for so long, it's they become very calm. They have a fresh air, they're happy, but they need again to move to the big city just to live their life in a big city because they get used to it.
Thanks for that. Just on a kind of separate topic, I wonder if you could perhaps give your thoughts on the humanitarian effort in Ukraine and, you know, the Scottish government's role in that.
When the war started, if I don't mistake, Scottish government has provided, Scottish NHS has provided with medicine supplies for £1.5 million. It's just only Scottish government, so that's really amazing. At the same time, we need to mention that all communities here in Scotland, they're helping Ukraine, they're donating supplies, money, baby boxes. I have visited one warehouse in Glasgow, and they're collecting baby boxes. And when I visited it, on the baby boxes, it was written the Scottish government, and I was asked them, like, so Scottish government has provided this, and they told, like, no, we are doing it on our own. They are collecting Scottish boxes through over the Scotland. They can collect just empty boxes, or a lot of moms in Scotland who gave a birth to kids, they just present these boxes, full boxes, just to this warehouse because they don't need it and they just want to help moms in Ukraine. And they're a big, really very big warehouse with a lot of these boxes. If the box empty, they just collect everything on their own. They just put all stuff and they are sending these boxes to Ukraine with lorries. Here in Edinburgh, our community, in Glasgow also, our community, they're just collecting all supplies, all donations, and they're sending it to Ukraine. Enormous support from Polish community in Scotland, because these guys are just crazy. They're in good words, really, in good case, because they're just crazy, because all what they are doing... They've bought an ambulance car for us. You know, they just did it. They've bought an ambulance car. They just found some Polish guy in Poland who came here. He picked it up and drive to Ukraine. Jesus, I was shocked when I heard the story and when I saw all this. But at the same time, Scottish government has provided also a lot of supplies, donations. The connections got... Connection Scotland has provided laptops and iPads for Ukrainians here, especially for kids who need to continue their studies. And Ukrainians were shocked. They were so happy to receive this because they really needed, because their kids were studying still online. And when they received it, and we are hoping that will continue. But nowadays they're really happy to receive this support. It's very, very useful for them because they continue their studies, and some people continue their job online thanks to these laptops and iPads or phones and so on. So I just can't say that Scottish Government is not supporting us in absolutely another way. You're doing they're doing their best. They're just giving all what they can for us. For example, when it was a football match, Scotland-Ukraine, sorry for this, it's just a football match. Unfortunately, we lost to Wales after that. Yeah. Scottish Government has provided us a bus for temporarily displaced Ukrainians who just wanted to visit the football match. We have arranged in consulates of Ukraine here with in cooperation with Scottish Government, and Scottish Government has paid for this, and thanks to Lossian Buses who has provided this bus, so they have paid for it. And Ukrainians who stay in temporarily displaced Ukrainians who are staying in Edinburgh, they had this possibility to go to Glasgow to visit the match. So that's one of the cases also. Scottish Government help us so much. They're providing supplies, donations, and if we are talking about Ukraine, maybe it will be really useful to provide some medicine supplies again. That's very important for us nowadays, and we need food, especially it's a long-term food, canned food, macaroni, some grains. So that's something that we need nowadays in Ukraine, really, and such type of supplies, it's very useful for us.
Thank you, that was very interesting. Back to the convener.
Thank you. I'm going to go to Mr. Cameron. We may not be able to see Mr. Cameron, but I think we'll be able to hear him online at least. Are you there, Donald?
I am there. I hope you can hear me. Good morning, Consul General, and apologies for not being there in person, but very good to see you, and thank you for coming to the committee this morning. My question is around reports a few weeks ago about certain refugees being moved from one location to another. I think it was from Livingston to Aberdeen, having settled in Livingston and then being asked to move. I just wondered if you had any observations on that. Was it a one-off, or have you had any other reports about that? And are you aware of what was... were there language issues that weren't overcome? Are you aware of what the problem there was?
Oh, thank you for your question. First of all, I didn't heard about this case. I didn't heard about this story. I will clarify it. I just wanted to visit Aberdeen, but I don't know when I will have this free time to visit it, to visit Ukrainians who are there. I will try to clarify these details, this story, because I didn't heard about this. I don't know what's the case, why they have been moved from Livingston to Aberdeen, but maybe it's... we need to clarify for how long they've been staying in Livingston, and... just why they've been moved to Aberdeen. Maybe the problem with local authorities, or people were applying just to move to another place because they don't like Livingston, or really very difficult to answer for this question. So I will clarify it, Mr. Cameron, and I will get back to you with this case. And regarding the language, as I have mentioned already, we need English classes, but at the same time, if we are talking about interpreters, so there are a lot of Ukrainian interpreters here in Scotland who are helping us in different cases, to the consulate, to community center in Glasgow, in Edinburgh, but at the same time, if... I can mention, yeah, if there will be some interpreters in welcome hubs, in airports, in high streets, that will be also very useful, because when people just arriving to Edinburgh and they don't speak English, if there will be some people who speak Ukrainian, they will be really happy. Because Not all of people know that, for example, in the Ukrainian consulate here work Ukrainian people. They're just thinking that we are Scottish, so we don't speak Ukrainian, and when they are calling us and we are answering them in Ukrainian, they are so shocked, and oh, it's so nice to hear my native language. So yeah, interpreters, it's very useful for us in welcome hubs or just in different places, because, but at the same time, for example, if we're talking about NHS, there are Ukrainian brochure on NHS website, so you can find all necessary information in Ukrainian, so it's not a problem, absolutely, and I'm really appreciative to NHS Scotland for this, because just yesterday I have checked it, yeah, it's in Ukrainian, you can receive all information in Ukrainian language, it's not a problem, absolutely, for you to register in GP. You can find all necessary information. Thank you.
So thank you for those answers. I'm very pleased to hear that, because it was language difficulties was one of the issues that we were worried about a few months ago, and it's good to know that those are basically being overcome. And in terms of other issues that are facing refugees once they arrive, you've highlighted many today. Are you satisfied that there is enough coordination between the various bodies that are involved, between, say, for example, the Scottish Government, local authorities, the NHS, the various third sector refugee groups? Do you feel that coordination is present?
So coordination between SG and consulate, for example, or SG and welcome hubs are just amazing, because we got regular meetings, and SG is providing me with all updates, all information, and I much appreciate them. I much appreciate to Mr. Gray, to departments in SG who are helping us, who are supporting us. It's really, they're doing their best. But at the same time, maybe that more useful of coordination between local authorities, because, for example, when people are coming here, they can receive some benefits, some part of their money is in welcome hub, but then they don't know where they can receive another part of money, so they need to look for it. They just need to go to city council, to local council, to local authority, or to welcome hub somewhere else, and they're just running because they don't know where they can receive these benefits. So that will be some case maybe where we can which we can discuss, where we can receive some more support. Thank you.
So just thank you. Just on that, where do you think the gap is in terms of receiving benefits? Is it between local authorities, between the various agencies? What do you think the precise issue is? Or don't you know? If you don't know, don't want to press you for an answer.
I think to myself that the gap is just because people don't know where to receive this information. If they will have this information, just that you can receive money there, you can receive supplies there, you can receive another benefits there. Just to show it to them, just to put it in internet or just to in some brochures that you need to apply or contact this email or contact this telephone number, and you will receive all information, all necessary information or where you can receive your benefits or your supplies. So just to provide this information in internet, on websites. For example, it is possible to do this on Edinburgh Airport website, because if you are writing in Google Welcome Hub, it's already at this time you can see the link for the Edinburgh Airport website, and you can see there all necessary information in English, in Ukrainian. So there are contact details, links for the websites. But at the same time, there is no contact details of local authorities or welcome hubs where people can receive their benefits. So that will be very useful to add this to this website. Thank you.
Thank you. That's something that we can take up with the Scottish Government. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Mintel?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming and sharing all your thoughts with us, which I'm sure must still be incredibly difficult for you. And as the Convener said in the introduction, we stand in solidarity with your country. Last week, for example, I was in Dunoon, which is part of my constituency, and the high school there had big Ukrainian flags surrounding its big games hall. So there is such a strength of feeling for your country. We've talked a lot this morning about Ukrainians that are coming to Scotland. I'm interested if you could give some of your thoughts on what's happening within Ukraine as well, what you can tell us about that. As my colleague Dr. Allen said, it's not we need to keep it in the public psyche, public awareness. So if you could share a bit about your thoughts that's going on in your home country.
Thank you for your question. First of all, mostly all of you know what's happening in Ukraine because thanks to media, especially to United Kingdom media, they are very brave people to be in Ukraine nowadays and to show Russian troops' military crimes to the world, shows what is going in Ukraine, and just to risk their lives because they are in a country where is the war nowadays. So, first of all, there are very difficult situation in the eastern part of Ukraine. Fights every day, especially for the city of Severodonetsk. At the same time, some cities, Kyiv, Odessa, they're trying to live their lives. Mykolaiv, Dnipro, so they're trying to renew their lives. I can tell you that more and more Ukrainians coming back to Ukraine every day. They're happy to be in Europe, they're happy to be in safe places, but Ukraine is our home, and all of us want to go back home because we need to rebuild our country, we need to renew our nation, so we need to do this. And that's why Ukrainians, they're happy to be here, but at the same time, they just want to go back home. So, and they are not scary because of the war, because of missiles is still flying, bombs, and they just going there. Unfortunately, there is still blockade of our seaports, as Odessa, Mykolaiv, and we can't transport our grain, and that's something that our government and trying to resolve. Because it's very important. So, and Russian troops is just continuing bombing our cities, just launching missiles to our cities, just to peaceful cities, and just they're just trying, continuing killing peaceful population, unfortunately. Already up to 300 kids has already died in Ukraine for these 3 months, unfortunately. And that's very difficult when you recognize that 300 kids has dead. But at the same time, we are trying to defend ourselves, we are trying to defend our country, and thanks to the support of the whole world, to the support of volunteers who joined an international legion, we are supporting our country. In some part of our country, our troops started counterattacks. They pulled back Russians back. So that's something that we are trying to do, to regain our territories and to win this war. And I hope that we will do this as soon as possible. Thank you.
I think we all hope the same and are standing behind you very strongly. Thank you.
Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thank you for sharing those thoughts. I wanted just to reflect on something you mentioned earlier on in the evidence session, and it was about transport. You said that there are some people who are living in the Highlands who maybe feel a wee bit isolated. There are people that need to travel to get advice and support. And then you also mentioned about families as well needing to access schools that are maybe not close by. I mean, you'll be aware that obviously in Scotland we have concessionary bus travel for over 60s and under 22s. I wondered if Ukrainian people who are living here have been able to access those schemes, and what you would think about the idea of extending concessionary travel, free travel on buses to all people who've been displaced and are temporarily living here in Scotland.
Thank you for the question. So first of all, yeah, they know about this. They are applying for this, but mostly of them are it's people who in the middle of 22 and 60s. So, and they are applying for bus tickets in our community center. So our our community here is, I don't remember where they take them, these bus tickets, but every time if people will visit our Ukrainian community center, they can receive bus tickets there. Also, they can receive them in Welcome Hub on High Street. But at the same time, maybe there will be some possibility to provide free rides just if you will show Ukrainian passport or for people in this middle from 22 to 60, or if they can apply just for 1 month bus pass or travel pass, something like this, as it was in Poland, in Germany, in Austria. So that's something that they really need, because transport is not cheap. So, and for example, even those who live in somewhere, I know, near the West End or in different part of Edinburgh, yes. So, and they just want to visit the community center on Tuesday and on Thursday. They just need to take a bus, need to pay it, and it's road from, for example, from Portobello to Royal Terrace and then back to Portobello. So it's not cheap for them. Unfortunately, because nowadays, yeah, they count every coin, so, because every coin is important for them.
Okay, thanks.
Well, it's interesting. I know in my own area we have a community transport bus, a couple of organisations that offer free transport for people, so that's maybe something I can ask them about, and other members may have a similar scheme to support the community here. Dr. Allen.
Just a supplementary, I realise we're jumping from subject to subject, but something that Jenny Minto said there about the situation in Ukraine itself, I wonder if you could say anything, given that there are war crimes taking place in your country, I wonder if you could say anything about what's happening in terms of prosecutors in Ukraine or international prosecutors being able to gather evidence around war crimes.
I understood you. Unfortunately, I don't have so lots of information regarding this, so it's better questions to the people in Ukraine and prosecutors in Ukraine. So, but yeah, there was some sessions of the courts already on Russian troops who killed peaceful people, and they were guilty. They were recognized as guilty, and they're in Ukraine nowadays. That's some of the cases. But if you will let me to finish all my speeches and answering all my questions, I would like to say how Ukrainians and just myself appreciate for the program of the SG for free studies for Ukrainians in universities and colleges. That's so important nowadays, really. So people. Just happy to hear this program, and we are trying just nowadays to clarify what's the process and terms of applying for study in universities and colleges, because terms of entering the college or university, it's just we need to get in touch with university. So, but people are so happy to have this program, and a lot of Ukrainian students will try to apply for this, and they just want to match studies in Ukraine and in Scotland. They will try to, they will see how they can do this, or they will change something. But we are much appreciated for this program, because it's very important nowadays for us. Thank you.
Sarah, you have a
final. Just a very brief entry to Alistair Allen's question about war crimes, because I'm working on the basis that people who are fleeing the war situation won't have been interviewed before they come to Scotland, and presumably there's a role once they get here to enable them to be able to record their experiences and be interviewed, so that they're, you know, they are able to give that evidence when their memory is still sharp, so that for the future there can be accountability for what's happened in Ukraine.
So, first of all, what I need to mention that we are in cooperation with Police of Scotland, and Ukrainians who came to Scotland, if they became a victim of war crime, or if they saw the war crime in Ukraine and now they're in Scotland, they can get in touch with Police of Scotland, and they can provide them all information, just to give them all details, what they have seen or what happened, and Police Scotland will do their best to help them. And all this can be, as far as I know, they need just to write an email or get in touch on the telephone number hotline. And after that, the Police Scotland will get in touch with these people, and they will clarify all details. So,
I think that's very useful. I just wanted to get that on the record, because I was aware, having met people supporting Ukrainians, that that's something that there's active discussion on, to make sure those experiences are not lost and that there's accountability in the future. Thank you so much for clarifying that.
Yeah, we had just... If you don't mistake, just previous week we had a meeting with representatives of Police Scotland in our community centre in Edinburgh, and we have discussed this. They have provided us with all information. We have shared it in the club, on our Facebook pages, on our websites, so people know where they can provide information about war crimes if they are here in Scotland. Thank you.
I think a final question for me, if you don't mind, Mr. Mankowski, and thank you for mentioning the extension of the support for students and colleges. And I think I mentioned to you, it was wonderful to see an STV report a couple of weeks ago showing the talent at the Royal Conservatoire of the two of the pianists who had taken up that offer from the Scottish Government. Early on, we did hear of a problem with the students who were here, who were finishing their studies, who were on student visas, and obviously those visas would come to an end this summer at the end of the academic year. Have those temporarily displaced Ukrainians been able to achieve an extension of that visa to remain, if they want to, in Scotland?
So as far as I know, yeah, if those who have been already studying here in Scotland, they can apply for extensional scheme. It's not a problem for them, so they can do this, and they can continue their studies here. They can stay in Scotland, and they will continue their studies, and there is no cases, no problems, no issues here in this, if we are discussing this. And also I need to mention that a few days ago, there was a big thing for all of us that Edinburgh University have signed the memorandum with Kyiv National University of Shevchenko, Kyiv National University, and that's very important for us, because Kyiv and Edinburgh is the twin cities from 1998, and so that's the start of something new, and we are hoping that that will be the beginning of something bigger in relations of two cities.
I guess that's a positive note to end on. Thank you so much for sharing your observations and experiences with us today. It's been really, really helpful. And I just know that the baby box that goes out in Scotland is a poem saying "Welcome, little one," from Jackie Kay. And I think that wish that's in that poem, we would wish for all the children of Ukraine at this time.
I was really touched when I visited this warehouse in Glasgow. I was just crying, really, because every time when I'm thinking about kids, my heart is broken. And especially when I saw these baby boxes, it was really amazing, because moms in Ukraine can receive the same stuff, the same supplies as they were receiving in a peaceful time. So that's really very useful, and that's a great thing.
Thank you very much. I'm going to suspend. Consul General, you're welcome to stay. We're about to have the Minister in to have some questions. I'm just going to suspend briefly for 5 minutes to swap over. Thank you very much. So welcome back, and for our second panel this morning on the crisis in Ukraine, welcome Neil Gray, Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development, and Minister with Special Responsibility for Refugees in Ukraine. Or we might change that to Temporary Displaced Ukrainians following the Consul General's intervention. So, Will Tyler Gregg, Interim Director, Deputy Director of Ukraine Resettlement in Scottish Government, and Joanne Keating, Head of International Development in the Scottish Government. And I know you've recently visited Poland, Minister, and I were interested in hearing about that, and can I invite you to make an opening statement?
Thank you very much indeed, Convener, and thank you to the committee for having me along again this morning. Last week, I visited Poland, as the Convener has outlined, to see firsthand how they have responded to the arrival of over 3 million displaced people from Ukraine and to show our solidarity with the Polish people who are supporting them. While there, I met the international aid organisations and the Polish government and was able to see how the £4 million of financial aid we are providing has made a difference. I also met with the inspirational leaders from civil society who are supporting people from the moment they arrive in Poland. I met volunteers at UNICEF's Blue Dot Centre. These are safe places at key transit points that provide families and children with critical information and services. UNICEF has used some of the £1 million from the Scottish Government to fund 24 Blue Dot Centres in countries neighbouring Ukraine, where there are a high number of displaced people. There is one particular part of this visit that will stay with me for a long time. At the start of the war, an unoccupied, disused shopping centre in Krakow was repurposed to welcome people who had fled Ukraine. It provided temporary accommodation and food, alongside support for mainly women and children. Donations of clothing and footwear are put on display, like a department store, giving people with dignity to choose the clothes that they need. But it was incredibly hard for me to see the way women and children are in particular are living in that refugee centre. The people around them are absolutely doing their best to make it the best possible for them. But that really showed for me, seeing firsthand, seeing, feeling, smelling the difficult situation that has been faced by the Ukrainian people has given me even greater determination to make sure that we are doing everything that we can in Scotland to provide the support that people arriving here need and deserve. It's clear to me that Scottish support for agencies on the ground in the region is still very much needed, and I'm also determined to do everything possible that we can to support Ukrainians whilst Scotland is their home. One of the major lessons from my visit is the need for national and local government in Scotland to fully utilise the power of the third sector and engage volunteer networks to help support displaced people settling in our communities. I'm immensely proud that we in Scotland have opened our homes to people fleeing this awful war, but it is clear that the work is far from done. You've already heard very well from my friend, the Consul General, about the work ongoing and the challenges that we have ahead. When we met in March, Scotland was preparing to welcome displaced people. We were determinedly pressing the UK government to waive visa requirements, and at that time, very few people had actually arrived in Scotland. We have moved on considerably since then. Since I last gave evidence to this committee, over 4,000 people have arrived with a Scottish sponsor, and around 70% of those arrivals have been sponsored by the Scottish Government. We have provided a safe and quick route for people to find safety in Scotland. Our local authorities have been working hard, supported by third sector partners, to do all we can to work within the UK government's visa scheme to welcome and support people arriving from Ukraine. A national matching service delivered by COSLA has been set up to match people arriving under the super sponsor scheme to longer term accommodation and make use of the generous offer of by the people of Scotland. The UK government's bureaucratic approach to this humanitarian crisis is well documented. We continue to press them to waive visas, to put people before process and provide local authorities with the funding they need to support people to rebuild their lives. Last week, the Welsh Government announced that they were pausing their own super sponsor scheme. I'm very sympathetic to their situation, and I know it will have been a very hard decision to reach, but that underlines the challenges that we're all facing in this situation. The First Minister has made it clear her intention for Scotland to welcome a fair and proportionate total number of displaced people from Ukraine who arrive in the UK, we are not planning to pause the Scottish super sponsor scheme. Our energy and focus is on building up the national matching service, providing people with longer term accommodation and integration support to make Scotland their home for as long as they need it to be. And I'm happy to take questions, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Minister, it was interesting to see that you're still of the opinion that the visa should be waived for approach into the UK. Regardless of the UK's European Union status, we're still part of the democratic world. And when the Deputy Convener and I attended the PPA earlier in the year, we had a session on Ukraine, and although we were observers and unable to take part, I particularly remember a Polish MEP talking about the pressures on Poland and the sense of frustration that the UK could be doing so much more to play its part, given the pressures on the immediate countries of Moldova and Poland and Hungary and also Germany, who are experiencing a large displacement as well. What representations are you still continuing to make to the UK government to change its position in this area?
Thank you, Convener. On visas, I think what serves to illustrate the position best is comparing the arrival numbers here in Scotland, just over 4,500, to the arrival numbers in Ireland, the Republic of Ireland. Geographically similar locations, similar sized nations. One has a visa requirement, one doesn't. And Ireland has over 10 times the number of arrivals of displaced Ukrainians. And I think that serves to illustrate the barrier that visa requirements are putting in the way of people being able to come to Scotland and, for that matter, the rest of the UK. You're absolutely right to underline the challenges that are being faced by the neighbouring countries. For a different reason, I was in Germany a couple of weeks ago and was able to visit community groups in Offenburg, in Baden-Württemberg, who are supporting displaced Ukrainians there. And they are dealing in Baden-Württemberg alone, a state in Germany, has welcomed over 100,000 displaced Ukrainians. And there are real challenges with those numbers, understandably. Similarly, when I was in Poland last week, it was clear that the third sector input is massive. There are also support in place from local and national government, but there are clear challenges in the neighbouring countries. And I feel, given what I saw in that centre supporting displaced Ukrainians, the disused shopping centre, seeing women and children, their pets, living cheek by jowl on camp beds, the heat was unbearable. I think it's incumbent on all of us to do everything that we can to support as many people coming here to Scotland as possible, Ukrainians and others fleeing conflict in similar situations.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from the committee. I'll go to Ms. Minto first, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, and your team for coming along today. I'm interested, you talked in your introduction, Minister, about your recent visit to Poland. If there's any other experiences from that that you can share with us. And also what you've highlighted the importance of the third sector. What learning did you get from what the third sector is doing in Poland and Germany, as you've highlighted, that perhaps the third sector in Scotland could learn from when we're welcoming Ukrainians here?
Thank you, Ms. Minto. I think, first of all, it's important to stress the incredible effort that's already ongoing from third sector partners and local authorities in Scotland. The work that they're doing is phenomenal and self-starting. You heard from Yevhen Mankovsky before me about some of that work and the impact that it's had in terms of direct support going to Ukraine. And I think that the comparison would probably be that in Poland, the third sector is far more involved at the initial welcome and is doing a lot more on the ground, whereas in Scotland there's a local government coordination that has been supported by the third sector. And I'm very grateful to the Scottish Refugee Council and others for all the work that they are doing in that regard. I think looking to see what more our third sector partners might be able to do so that the the full Team Scotland approach can be deployed, because this is, you know, a huge challenge that we're all facing, that we all want to overcome, and that we want to ensure works incredibly well for those who are arriving in, from Ukraine. But I think the other lesson that I've taken from the visit to Poland is the fact that our Scottish Government support is seeing tangible results, and it was tangible and clear in evidence to me, visiting the Blue Dot Centre, visiting Caritas, who work with SCIAF, who we funded, visiting the Red Cross Centre, seeing the work that they are doing to support people as they arrive in Poland, and knowing what they are doing on the ground in Ukraine as well. It was clear to me that our support is been well utilised, and the fact that there are, sadly, is a job for both large NGOs that we've supported and also smaller NGOs. And some of the smaller NGOs, Open Krakow, for instance, led by Maria Wojtacza in Krakow, absolutely incredible. You know, that the support alongside the accommodation that has been provided there, the giving dignity to people in a really challenging situation, I take my hat off to them, and I was able to articulate that and pass on my thanks to them for the work that they're doing. So it was a very useful trip for me in terms of taking back lessons and working that we're already trying to deploy within the response here in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was saying to the consul earlier that last week I was in Dunoon Grammar School, and they had Ukrainian flags. And as I drive from here to Argyll and Bute, there is so much support across various communities for Ukraine. I'm interested to hear a bit more about what we can do from a soft power perspective to support Ukraine.
Thank you. I think we have been doing a huge amount already. There's more that clearly can be done. I was at the Solidarity rally a week past on Sunday. Started at the Russian consulate and ended up at outside the Scottish Parliament. And the support on the streets was incredible. Like you, as I'm going back and forth in my constituency in Airdrieshaws and around Scotland, I can see, as Mr. Mankowski had also articulated, the sight of Ukrainian flags, the colours everywhere, wearing the Ukrainian tartan, as is the convener. You know, we're doing everything that we can in the ways that the small ways that we feel feel small, but actually, as Mr. Mankowski had articulated, every small bit like that, when we're tagging, you know, hashtagging Stand With Ukraine, when we're Slava Ukraini, when all of these things matter to people that I was speaking to in and around Poland, that I'm speaking to in Scotland as well, because the situation is incredibly challenging, as we've already heard. You know, people are worried about their family members, they're worried about their property, they're worried about the future of their nation, and so everything that we can possibly do to support them and show solidarity is worth doing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm very much in agreement with that Stand With Ukraine sentiment, and can tell it's made a personal impact on you, having been across to Poland and seen the reality on the ground. I think my questions are really more about how you're monitoring the super sponsor scheme. What does success look like for you? Because the feedback I've had, and if you look at the submissions we've had from different representatives, Just Right Scotland, COSLA, Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership, there's a real gap between what our ambitions are collectively and actually the capacity of local authorities to actually deliver on the ground. So I'd like to ask a bit about the monitoring you're doing on the impact of people being stuck in hotels for weeks before they get linked up with a sponsor. We got feedback from the Consul General that there's a particular issue for women with children, for whom being stuck in a hotel is just totally wrong for them. There's also a particular issue I've picked up, which is that people, when they get stuck in a hotel, the routes they put down are with the Ukrainian support community, but that makes it even harder once they are given an allocation, if it's not in that area, because they've already made routes and they've got support. So what are you doing to speed up that matching process? And the issue, I'd like a comment about you about people being stuck in hotels, because the experience from Afghan and Syrian communities is that they are still stuck in temporary accommodation, and that's got a huge issue in terms of accessing schools, the health, the PTSD support, and particularly accessing NHS dentistry. I've had hosts getting in touch who are really worried about the Ukrainians there trying to support, about who they contact, because it's really hard to get those links on the ground.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I understand all of those concerns, and I don't want to see people in hotel rooms for any longer than is absolutely necessary. And we are working with local authorities to ensure that we are building the capacity around the matching service. We've committed resource to that. We're in constant dialogue with our local authority partners to ensure that there is as much clarity around how that process works, around taking feedback around where they may need more help, and ensuring that there is also flexibility around local matching as well, to make sure that where it's possible, local government and the local authority teams are able to use their local knowledge to be able to take matches forward quicker if that's possible. I'm looking for us to do anything and everything to be considered to ensure that we're getting this moving as quickly as possible. And it shows the challenge of the fact that, you know, looking at what Wales has had to do over the last couple of weeks, and there is no judgment from me over that, because I can understand the pressures that they will have been under. But it shows the challenge of this having been an immigration scheme rather than a formal resettlement scheme, and the different levels of support that come from the two that make it more challenging for us to respond. And we'll certainly do everything that we can to make sure that we're responding appropriately. You're absolutely right that for as long as people are in, even in hotel accommodation, they start to put down roots, they make community connections, they make community contacts, their children start to make friend networks, and that's great. But that makes it challenging if there is a need to move people on to other areas, and we want to be as sympathetic as possible to that. But it just shows why it's so important that we get the matching service operational as quickly as possible, so that we're able to provide people with a long-term accommodation, provide them with a settled community that allows them to put down those roots as quickly as possible. I'm alive to all of those. We are constantly monitoring the situation. We're in constant dialogue with our teams and colleagues in local government, and we'll continue to provide the support that they feel is necessary to ensure that we can get people into the longer-term secure accommodation as quickly as possible.
That's useful as far as it goes, Minister. It's the answers to the detail on those issues, I think, that is really important. Highland Council, for example, tells us that the lack of guidance from the Scottish Government is actually creating a major problem for them now. And they mention that in terms of the super sponsorship scheme and contingency planning. And COSLA gives us a big list of problems they have with the matching service at the moment. So I hope you can get a copy of these papers, and it might be useful if we got a briefing back from you, because we're...
I couldn't possibly answer all the questions today
because there are so many of them.
Yeah, I would be interested to see what further guidance Highland Council is looking for, because with respect, we've provided significant guidance on how that we expect the system to work, and we are looking to make sure that we are working in partnership with our local government partners. And if there are concerns that they have that they wish to raise, then we would hear that and would work through them as quickly as possible. Similarly, with COSLA, I'm in constant dialogue with COSLA. I had a meeting with the President on Monday. I had a meeting only 2 weeks previous with COSLA, trying to find a way to make sure that we're getting the matching service working as quickly as possible. But if the committee have any particular areas that they would want to write to me about, to ask questions, I'd be more than happy to write back in a timeous fashion to ensure that you're given confidence that we're taking all of these issues incredibly seriously, that we're working through all of the or any of the concerns and questions that have been raised with us. Because the first point that you acknowledged, Ms. Boyack, was around the impact that visiting Poland has had on me, and the determination that I have that we do everything possible, that we commit as much resource as we can, both from government and local government and the third sector, to ensure that we are giving people arriving from Ukraine and those arriving from other war zones the opportunity to make Scotland their safe, supportive home for as long as they need it.
that's a very useful commitment. To be specific, the quote from the Highland Council paper was, "The lack of funding instructions from Scottish Government prevents the Council from planning ahead for this resettlement scheme." So that's my second question, really, is about that planning ahead. When I visited the Ukrainian community last week, I actually heard of somebody who's been given their 2 months' notice for leaving their sponsor because it's a six-month scheme. So we're not just at the point of matching people with their super sponsor, but people in the next few weeks are actually going to start running out of the 6 months. So it's to ask you what's been done to think ahead. And I both declare an interest in terms of my former employment and the Lothian MSP in terms of the lack of affordable social housing in the city. It's already a huge issue. So what work is going to be done, not just medium term, but short term, to address that issue of accessible housing? The Consul General talked about temporary accommodation and the fact that our standards of housing are, he thinks that refugees would go for people fleeing from Ukraine would take slightly lower standards, but we've got our own health and safety standards. So what is going to be done maybe to get access to social housing, to get longer term placements for people so that particularly those women with children can both get their kids stable, settled, can get access to PTSD, can get access to employment? Because however enthusiastic people are to get back to Ukraine, we know that for many of them, it's not just their home has been bombed, but it's their whole community's been eradicated. So it's that issue about where are we going to put people up and what can we do now in terms of access to affordable housing so that they can at least make their home in Scotland, even if it's only going to be for 1 or 2 years. But the hosting process doesn't tick the box for that. So what's next and what are you doing?
Thanks, Ms Boyett. There's a number of things in that I'll try to respond to in turn. First, in terms of the funding situation that Highland Council are expressing concern about, I'm not surprised that they're expressing concern about that, because we share those concerns. I've stated publicly a number of times in the Chamber, I think in this committee, and in every meeting that I have with the UK Government, around the lack of parity that there is between those that have arrived in the family scheme and those that are arriving in the super sponsor scheme or the Homes for Ukraine scheme. The Homes for Ukraine scheme, people arriving have a £10,500 tariff that is supposed to go to local authorities. There is still an issue there around that having arrived, which I'm happy to turn to as well. But those arriving on the family scheme are not, the local authorities that are hosting them are not getting that same support. And you and I know, convener, that regardless of how somebody arrives from Ukraine, the resource commitment that is going to be required from local government is going to be the same. There's going to be the same support required. So I can give reassurance to Highland Council and all other local authorities that we are doing absolutely everything that we can as a government in our conversations with the UK government to get certainty and parity of funding. The second point to make around funding is the fact that at the moment we only have certainty for funding for this first year. We have not been given a commitment from the UK government yet around what is going to happen in year two or indeed year three, because this is a three-year visa system. The next point that you made around housing and the fact that people are feeling vulnerable because the initial 6 months is coming close to an end, I can understand that feeling of vulnerability. The communication that the UK government made was that the arrangements would be for, if people could commit to it, would be for at least 6 months. I'm not going to make any statement to say that I expect people to, those that are hosting, to go beyond what they feel would be appropriate. But we're already planning and have been doing a lot of work in terms of bringing social housing on to make it available. We've provided local government with £11 million in order to repurpose, to bring void properties back into use. We're in conversations with RSLs, as you'd expect, as Ms Boyack would expect, given her previous employment. And they have been doing a very good job at helping us to make sure that there are social housing options available. There are a number of areas that we're working on. to try to make sure we're giving people the certainty and the security that they need and deserve in the social space. Obviously, that as people are hopefully finding employment, there's also opportunities for people to transition to their own arrangements, particularly if they're looking to stay here for longer. So we're working through all of that, and if there are any specific areas of concern that she has, I can understand the situation that she's expressed in Edinburgh, which is why we're keen to make sure that we're having a full Scotland, all 32 local authority approach, as there was for the Syria scheme, to make sure that the natural inclination of people to wish to be near or around Edinburgh, it's articulated that there are opportunities beyond Edinburgh. We've got colleagues here from the Western Isles, from Argyll and Bute, from Mid Scotland, Fife, from the northeast, from Central Scotland. You know, that would all articulate the various merits of their particular areas and the opportunities that there are in those areas to find employment, to put down roots, and to contribute to find homes in those areas. And I would hope that we can all continue to articulate the opportunities that are available across Scotland to make sure that the particular pressures that Ms Boyack as articulated in Edinburgh can be avoided in the long term.
Thank you. Reiterate that getting the answers to some of those questions would be much appreciated, because they are now issues, they're not future issues, and it was about the super sponsorship scheme that Highland Council were looking for clarity on in terms of funding. And if you look at the COSLA paper, the list of issues, it would be really good to get a set of answers. For example, they talk about transport, that the host councils don't have the transport capacity to arrange for hosts to be put with their matches, and it's not a model elsewhere in the UK. So where we're volunteering and we have to come up with new schemes, this all needs to be done urgently, because it's not happening at the moment. Thank you.
I would challenge that. There are areas where that is happening, and we've got examples of local authorities putting in place travel schemes to ensure people are able to move around. We've already talked about the travel provision that's available, and you've heard from Mr. Mankowski around some of that already. However, if there are the issues that have been raised by COSLA, I would imagine, would be issues that we are discussing in our meetings regularly, and I'd be more than happy if the committee wanted to write to me with any of the particular issues that they wanted more information on that I haven't been able to provide clarity on, or too long a list to read out today, then I'd be more than happy to respond in detail in a timeous fashion. I give that commitment to the convener, Ms Boyack.
Thank you.
Mr Bolton. Thank you, convener. Minister, we heard earlier today that there are approximately 500 Ukrainians staying in a hotel for 1 month or more. I wondered if that is a number that you recognise, and if so, how long will it be before it's addressed?
So I would, if I was to put an estimation, I don't think it would be far away from where the committee had already discussed, and that this is not a situation that we want to see happening. We don't want people in hotel rooms for any longer than is absolutely necessary, for all the reasons that Mr. Mankowski had articulated, the pressures that there are on families, mothers with young children in particular. I perfectly understand that, and absolutely sympathise with it. I cannot imagine the challenge that would be living out of a hotel room. And the committee can be reassured that the Scottish Government, working with local government, with our third sector partners, are doing everything we can. And I have placed an even greater emphasis, given my visit to Poland and seeing how people are living there, to ensure that we are doing everything. We are leaving no stone unturned in terms of how we can commit the resource, both human and financial, to ensuring that we are getting the matching service moving as quickly as possible. There are already a reasonable number of matches that have been made. The matching service, it does work. We just need to make sure that it is happening as quickly as possible. There are different reasons why there is a challenge there. Some people who have offered their properties, their circumstances have changed, and those conversations have to happen. It's a resource-intensive process to be able to go through those discussions to ensure we can understand what the circumstances people have. But you know, I'd be happy to speak to anybody that feels that they have additional ideas or ways of ensuring that we're able to answer this situation and make sure we're getting this moving as quickly as possible.
Thank you, Minister. We've heard previously from COSLA that they have not received all their funding promised, and indeed Highland Council submitted evidence to that regard as well. So I just wondered, from the Scottish Government perspective, can you confirm that that position has now been rectified?
I'm happy to be corrected, but I don't think any money has ever been held back by the Scottish Government. The £11 million is there for local government to utilise in terms of to ensure that housing provision is made available and in a flexible way for local authorities to use as they wish, to ensure that they can provide accommodation to their to people that are being hosted in their communities. I'm not aware of any money having ever been held back from the Scottish Government. There is a question mark over when the money will be arriving from the UK Government, the £10,500 tariff, and there is a serious question mark over whether that £10,500 is enough for local authorities to be able to provide the service provision that is required to ensure that we are providing that wraparound support that we need. We are looking at what we can do to ensure that local government is properly supported in that regard. And there's also a question mark around the UK Government having not given any further commitment to the funding beyond this year. And so anything that Mr. Golden can do to articulate some of the concerns that he's clearly received to amplify that, I'd be very grateful for his support on.
So just to clarify, under the Scottish Super Sponsorship Scheme, Highland Council have said the lack of funding instructions from Scottish Government prevents the Council from planning ahead for this resettlement scheme. Is that incorrect?
I'm happy to discuss with Highland Council any concerns they have about or any other local authority for that matter. The challenges that they are concerned about in the longer term situation, and we work with local government organisations, with SOLAS, with COSLA, to ensure that there are long term planning in place. I'm very grateful to local government for the work that they are already doing, and if there is anything more that the Scottish Government can do to ensure that local government are able to support the system that we have in place, then I'm more than happy to hear that and more than happy to work with them with anything that we can ensure that we're providing the warm Scottish welcome that that we expect, our constituents expect, but most importantly that we should expect and is deserved by the people arriving from Ukraine.
Thanks, Minister. To date, none of the Scottish Government's humanitarian emergency fund has been used to support the humanitarian crisis in the Ukraine. Are there any plans in place to deploy this fund?
So I'm happy to bring Joanna Keating in at this point in terms of providing clarification around the process for the activation of HEF. As far as I'm aware, there hasn't been a request made, but I'm happy to bring Joanna at this stage just to clarify that point.
Thanks very much. So the money that we have the £1 million humanitarian emergency fund, which we have annually. So last year that was spent other than Ukraine, but there was £4 million additional made available for Ukraine specifically. Going into this financial year, we have the new £1 million available. We have a humanitarian panel, which is made up of international NGOs, Oxfam, SCIAF, Tier Fund, Red Cross, etc. And so what happens is that the panel comes to the Scottish Government, they activate, we call it activating for a crisis. So they will look around globally, decide where there's a particular crisis and which meets the criteria that they're looking at and where their members are already active. So many members of the HEF panel have already received funding for Ukraine. So the likes of Red Cross, SCIAF, And also through the money that we gave to the DEC Appeal as well, again, those organisations. So that's the system, really. It's about four, you know, we have appointed a panel which actually takes the decisions on activation. So other than where there's a DEC Appeal that is launched, and there was one launched, obviously, for Ukraine earlier this year, that's the system. So if the panel looked and decided that they wanted to activate for Ukraine, that would be looked at. But equally, they will activate for many other crises around the world, you know, sort of DRC. The Horn of Africa is a particular humanitarian crisis at the moment, and also actually just seeing the impact from Ukraine on Africa as well in terms of food prices, famine, you know, the World Food Programme concerns, etc. So the Horn of Africa, there's a particular humanitarian crisis at the moment.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, panel. Back to you, Convener.
Okay. Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I just wonder if you could say a little bit more about the UK's approach, the visa approach that's been taken. You mentioned that it's very different from that in Ireland, but as far as I think we can all understand, it's pretty different from everywhere in Europe. How unusual is it, and what are the conversations that you have with the UK government about that?
Dr. Allen is correct that the UK is the only European nation that is requiring visas for those fleeing the war in Ukraine. And I think we have to ask why that would be the case when every other European nation has opened its doors, has allowed people to enter and then go through put people before process, why the UK can't. And I've already referenced Ireland because of its geographical location. Mr. Mankowski has articulated earlier very well the fact that people want to stay close to Ukraine, and that's understandable. They've got family reasons, they've got property that they want to check. But for those that are, you know, perhaps looking for different opportunities, you can see and are willing to travel further afield, you can see the different arrival numbers between Scotland and Ireland, and the major difference is the visa requirements. And we know that Ireland has welcomed 10 times the number that Scotland has. And that should embarrass us all, because I think that we all have a collective responsibility to do everything that we can to make sure that we're doing everything possible from a humanitarian point of view to support people displaced from Ukraine. And I commend the efforts, as I did when I was in Poland, when I was in Germany, of those communities that are you know, opening their doors in other parts of Europe, as I commend people in Scotland and the rest of the UK that are looking to do everything that they can to welcome people here in Scotland.
Yeah, and thinking back to what you said there about the notional sum allocated by the UK government of £10,500 to some schemes but not others, you expressed concern there about the equity between the different schemes. But do you have any concerns about that sum itself, and what is it that local authorities would be expected to cover from it?
So local authorities would be expected to cover all areas of wraparound support that they have a responsibility to deliver. Social work, education, all manner housing, all manners of areas of responsibility that local government have. And I am concerned that £10,500 is not sufficient. I don't believe that it is in parity, has parity with previous resettlement scheme support numbers. I've articulated that both in terms of the overall quantum and in terms of the parity between different routes to the UK with the UK government repeatedly. My colleagues have as well, right up to the First Minister. I think that there is sympathy for the position, particularly around parity between the visa routes. I think Michael Gove and Lord Harrington have expressed sympathy, but at the moment that sympathy has not extended to Treasury extending support. And my call today would absolutely to ensure, at the very least, if we're not talking about the overall quantum of the £10,500, then at least ensure that there's parity of support regardless of how people arrive.
And finally, Convener, on another subject, we've talked a little bit, or alluded a little bit today, to rural areas. Of course, many rural areas need both new people and also need new houses as well. With money going in from the government end just now into social housing, appreciate the displaced persons may not want to stay here long term, but should local authorities and other agencies be be factoring in the needs of displaced persons when they come to their planning on housing in rural areas as well.
Absolutely, I would hope that should go without saying. And to be fair, the conversations that I've had with local government, that they're looking to do everything that they can. But Dr. Allen is absolutely right. It represents a community that has suffered depopulation and has depopulation challenges, but also has many opportunities and a beautiful place to live and work and to ensure that people have a good place to raise a family. So I think what we have to do is we have to understand that people arriving from Ukraine will have probably as much understanding of Scotland as we perhaps have understanding of Ukraine. We'll know about Kyiv, but we'll know only from what we've seen on the television. And so I think it's incumbent on all of us to make sure that we are articulating the opportunities that there are beyond Edinburgh, beyond Glasgow, as wonderful cities they are, about saying that there are opportunities beyond the Central Belt, and that some people who are arriving will be looking to find employment very quickly. Others will be in a different situation, and there's no pressure there. But for those that are looking to find work opportunities, I think Dr. Allen articulates well, given the community he represents, and I see Ms. Minto nodding her head, given the community that she represents in Argyll and Bute, that there are employment opportunities beyond the Central Belt, and that hopefully we can ensure that people enjoy the whole of Scotland and the pressures on Edinburgh and Glasgow can be released a little bit as a result of that.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Can we move to Mr. Ruskell, please?
Thanks. I met with staff recently from the Ukrainian Advice Centre and the Worker Support Centre, and the government's financing of those is obviously very, very welcome and much needed at this point. But the picture, as I understand it, is that the Ukrainian extension scheme has been, relatively straightforward in terms of advice cases that are coming forward, legal advice that's required. But the Ukraine family scheme and the sponsorship scheme does throw up much more complex immigration advice support that's needed, legal advice that's required. And at the moment, a lot of that is being provided on a very much a pro bono basis. Do you have an understanding of what that ongoing support might look like and what the resource might be required to actually ensure that people are getting what they need? Because obviously there are issues around legal aid being unavailable for many people. So.
Yeah, thank you, and I thank Mr. Ruskell for his question. We are providing support through Just Right Scotland and ensuring we constantly review the level of support that's going to be required to Just Right Scotland to ensure that we are meeting the demand that people have to access advice around their status. I'm hopeful that the capacity that we've put in place at Just Right Scotland will ensure that we're able to meet the demand. But there's also, as Mr. Ruskell has pointed out, that the extension scheme has been useful up until a point because it gives people certainty up until the end of this year, is my understanding. But again, in terms of parity, we don't have parity between those that are, on the seasonal workers visa and those that are arriving through Homes to Ukraine or the family visa scheme, whether it's 3 years. So we've asked that get rectified and that we have better parity to give people better certainty. There's also an issue around people on the seasonal worker scheme are unable to sponsor family members to come. The workaround has been, used through the super sponsor scheme, where people can have the Scottish Government sponsor them and then they're able to meet up with their family, and that has been a workaround. But I think it would be fairer to ensure that there is parity across all the schemes, and that again speaks to the challenges of having an immigration response to a humanitarian crisis as opposed to a proper resettlement scheme that we would normally see.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of longer term integration support, advice around employability, Mr. Mankowski was clear earlier on that the vast majority of Ukrainians want to return. However, I'm also hearing from the advice centres that there may be some who have been displaced perhaps several times through war and may wish to remain, may wish to look at longer term employment opportunities within the UK, should they choose that. How are you factoring that in? I mean, obviously there's the complexity around visas and everything else and the UK government policy, but how are you supporting people if they want to remain within the UK and Scotland?
I have full sympathy with that. I mean, you know, anecdotally, when I was in Krakow, I met Alan Ruznik, who was originally from Bosnia, had fled the war in Sarajevo when he was 13, had his family moved to Slovenia, was having moved around the world for work, feeling very transient, had ended up in Barcelona, was working as a chef at the outbreak of the war, felt a real calling to go and do something to help, and had felt that returning to Slovenia would be his way of helping, because he knew Slovenia. Ended up in Krakow, had a 7-hour stopover before his next train, asked around and ended up at the World Food Kitchen outside the disused shopping centre that I was talking about, and is now there, living on a camp bed in the accommodation that has been provided alongside the other displaced Ukrainians and volunteering his services. An incredible man, and it was really emotional speaking to him, and I pay tribute to the work that he and others are doing from around the world to help on the ground. But that feeling of transience, of not knowing where your home actually is as a result of having fled one or two or however many conflict zones and having to find and rebuild your life, it must be incredibly challenging, very hard, and that's why I'm so determined that we do everything that we can to obviously provide the initial sanctuary, to provide the initial safety in Scotland, but then also give people the support that they need to be able to rebuild their lives, to ensure that they can call Scotland their home for as long as possible. I'm going to bring in Will Tyler Gregg to give more detail on the Worker Support Centre that we have provided funding to, because ensuring that people have access to employment support, to give them the resource, the independence that they desire. You know, my conversations with Yevhen Gankovsky over many months, that feeling of a desire for independence and for their own sustainability is very, very strong for people arriving from Ukraine. Sometimes it's not possible, and I understand that people are arriving with horrendous trauma. And I've got examples of children in my constituency that I've seen where that has had a profound impact. But for those that are able to or that want to, we want to make sure that we're doing everything possible to provide that support, and I'm keen to bring Will in to provide more detail around the Worker Support Centre and the integration support.
I mean, in addition to Just Right, which we heard about earlier, the Scottish Government has invested £41,000 into a Worker Support Centre, which is using a model which is used elsewhere around the world to provide advice to seasonal workers. For those that have arrived through the super sponsor route, there are a variety of agencies that are providing support, including Skills Development Scotland. Obviously, DWP is also into hotels and meeting with individuals to talk about access to benefits. And obviously those that need support straight away can access the Scottish Welfare Fund as a sort of bridging gap, which is also not repayable, unlike Universal Credit.
Okay. Final question is about transport, and again, we heard from Mr. Mankowski earlier about just some of the challenges, and you spoke yourself, Minister, about the need for independence for people that are living here and dignity as well. I mean, it's clear that some people are living in quite isolated situations, particularly in rural areas, that they need to travel to access advice and support. They often need to travel to access school and other facilities as well. And although some people will be eligible for National Entitlement Card for free bus, there is a big gap in the middle. And you've spoken yourself about how councils are trying to fill that by buying tickets and having those available at hubs and everything else. Wouldn't it just be a lot simpler for us to extend the National Entitlement Card to displaced people in Scotland? Because the current entitlement extends to up to 2.6 million people, in terms of Ukrainians, we're talking about 4,500 people who are here. So it's a rounding error in terms of the budget that's available for concessionary travel in Scotland. And it would clearly be transformational for people who are here who don't have access to cars, don't have access to many of the transport advantages that we have, and probably are the most needy in terms of needing access to transport for independence and dignity and everything else.
Thank you, Convener. I thank Mark Ruskell. Everything that he has said, I support absolutely in principle. And following the meeting, my last appearance here, when Mr. Sweeney was substituting, I had a very productive meeting with Mr. Sweeney and Mr. Doris around this very issue, and alongside Transport Scotland officials and others. And we are trying to work our way through trying to find a system that would avoid the need for complex legislation, because there are complexities in extending and about making sure we're able to identify who we're extending it to and how that would work. So we're trying to find a way through that situation. We've got great sympathy for it. And I very much appreciate the work that, as Mr. Ruskell has pointed out, that has been done by local authorities across Scotland. You know, he mentioned Stirling. There are many others that in Glasgow and Edinburgh and across Scotland that are doing fantastic work to provide transport support. I would say I wouldn't dismiss the entitlement that is already available. Not long after that committee meeting, I actually met with Mr. Mankowski and we were discussing this very issue, and I was explaining to him the entitlement that people already have, given their age and what have you. And that was something that at that stage I don't think had been communicated with the Ukrainian community about the entitlement that's already available. It doesn't cover everybody. It covers, I think it's just over half. And we're looking to see what we can do about the other half, about ensuring that they have support as well.
Can I ask you when you might be able to get that over the line? Because, you know, some of the complexity around the National Entitlement Card has been around documentary evidence and providing that to the Improvement Service in order to get the card. Presumably, displaced people are some of the most highly documented people in our society, so it should be relatively simple in technical terms. I understand there might be a legislative need for an updated SI, maybe to go to committee to extend the franchise further. But can you give us a sense of a horizon here and when government may come to a decision on this? Because we're now entering into the summer. People need this. As you said, it's actually less than 4,500. It's probably only 2,500, given that we've got both ends of the age spectrum. It's the families in the middle. It's the mums with kids, as Mr. Mankowski said earlier on, who are really struggling at the moment. So that's the gap. It's a small gap. When can we fill it?
That's a fair challenge. I wish I could give a definitive answer to it. I can't. And even when, you know, the ask that's come from Mr. Doris and Mr. Sweeney is for asylum seekers and refugees in general, not just displaced mm-hmm. Ukrainians, and trying to ensure that we can make a move, if it's possible to do it, to provide something on a national basis. That is where the additional complexity will lie. But I'll give a commitment that we'll make sure to write to the committee and write to Mr. Ruskell, given his interest in this area, and provide an update on how we're progressing with that.
Thanks, Camille.
Thank you. I'm going to invite Mr. Cameron in.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. Apologies for not being there in person. I'd like to just follow up on a couple of questions that I asked Consul General. The first one was the reports about there's displaced persons being moved from Livingston to Aberdeen a couple of weeks ago. And just to ask the Scottish Government's response to that, was it a one-off, and what is the Minister aware of the reasons behind that? I'd be grateful for any explanation that he could give, please.
Thank you, Convener. I thank Mr. Cameron for that question. Yes, I'm aware of the circumstances. We had challenges of temporary accommodation availability at that particular weekend, and ensuring that we had availability for people who we knew were going to be arriving into Edinburgh, which is the arrival point predominantly for the whole of Scotland, there was a need to ensure that we asked voluntarily some of the displaced Ukrainians that were in the hotel in Livingston whether or not they would be willing to move elsewhere. And a bus was put on in order for that to happen. Some still travelled. There was an incident and an issue that I think is regrettable around, that I think caused additional harm and stress to those who were potentially travelling. I think it's important to stress that lessons have been learned there in terms of communication from all of us about ensuring that we are communicating as well as possible with not just displaced Ukrainians, but those who are supporting them around the reasons for why. I've already articulated that the committee has already articulated around the challenges that there are in Edinburgh and the local area in terms of making sure that there's a whole of Scotland approach articulating why different parts of Scotland provide different opportunities and also making sure that we're able to articulate to people why it is that we need sometimes to move. But I think the necessity for a move like that is much reduced given the situation that we're now in, and I want to reduce that even further by making sure that we progress the matching service as quickly as possible and allow people to get into longer term accommodation.
So are you confident that that kind of situation won't happen again?
I certainly hope so. There's always going to be a need for people to be moving in Scotland because, as I've already articulated, Edinburgh is the arrival point for the vast majority of people arriving from Ukraine. However, whichever country they're arriving from, they're arriving into Edinburgh predominantly, not exclusively, but predominantly. And it's clearly not sustainable for people to be staying in the Edinburgh area for a long period of time because, as Ms. Boyack has already articulated, there are accommodation pressures in Edinburgh as it stands. And so there is always going to need to be a couple of moves for people to put down their roots. But I'm wanting to limit that as much as possible and ensure that there is communication in place that ensures that people from Ukraine are understanding all stages, when there is a move in place, that it is voluntary and that people understand the process that they're going through.
Thank you for that. Can I move on to the question of information about benefits, which the Consul General touched on? I don't know if you were able to hear all his evidence.
Yes, I did.
But that's helpful. He suggested there was an issue about information around benefits, and I just wondered if you could elaborate on that. Is that a matter for the DWP? Is it a matter for the Welcome Hubs publishing or making available the right information? Is there anything you can illustrate or help us with in terms of that issue?
So there are a number of areas here that I think would be important to provide clarity on. The first is, I think I'll have a conversation with Mr. Mankowski later on this, but I think some of the challenge here is around people understanding how far they are away from the social security support they qualify for actually arriving with them. And part of that, obviously, as Mr. Cameron will be well aware, is, you know, there is a 5-week wait inbuilt into Universal Credit that we all know the challenges that result from that. I don't think we're going to resolve that particular situation today, but I think it just serves to illustrate the inbuilt 5-week wait poses major challenges for people in Scotland, the rest of the UK, and those arriving from Ukraine as well. And I think it is another argument why the UK government needs to resolve the structural issues with Universal Credit that I previously, in a previous life, had campaigned hard on. The second issue that I would like to raise is the fact that is the one that Mr. Tyler Gregg had already raised, that the availability of the Scottish Welfare Fund fund for people arriving from Ukraine, particularly to fill the gap where the DWP's five-week wait for universal credit exists, is available. We've provided support and guidance to local authorities around ensuring that that is made available to people arriving from Ukraine. Obviously, we are doing everything we can through Social Security Scotland for those that have more complex issues entitlements to Scottish Social Security to ensure that the range of entitlements that are available in Scotland are articulated to the welcome hubs, and that is all progressed and processed as people are arriving and going through the welcome hubs.
Thank you for that. And I think, you know, conversations between yourself and the Consul General would be really helpful in that regard. Can I finally just sort of reiterate the points made by Sarah Boyack and Maurice Golden about the various issues that have arisen in submissions before us, principally from COSLA, but also the Highland Council. And that appears to be very much about the provision of information from Scottish Government to local authorities. And I don't know if we can provide you as a committee with those points in due course. COSLA makes certain points about challenges facing the matching service, which include complex cases, the fact that there are many large families with no available matching properties. They talk about the property requirement, having to be near a job or a place of education. They talk about pets, they talk about transport. There are a number of, sort of issues that are clearly arising within the matching service and the super sponsorship scheme. And I suppose this isn't really a question, but it's just very, I think, important that Scottish Government is aware of these and is hopefully able to resolve them as best they can. So not really a question, but really just a final sort of observation for the Minister. Please feel free to come back on it.
Well, Convener, I'm happy to answer the statement that Mr. Cameron has given, which follows up from, as he's already articulated, the questions that have come from Ms. Boyack and Mr. Golden. I'll bring in Will Tyler-Greg in terms of the direct communications with Highland Council, but I reiterate that Scottish Government, local government, our third sector partners, we're doing everything we can, working together to drive more pace into the matching service. I've already articulated some of the challenges that Mr. Cameron clearly agrees with in terms of where that is resource intensive, where there are discussions that are required in terms of whether the expression of interest is still available, you know, what people are expecting, both those from Ukraine or those hosting here in Scotland. It takes time, but I'm keen that, as I'd said earlier, particularly following my visit to Poland, that we are redoubling our efforts to ensure that this happens at pace and so that we can do everything possible to make this a success and avoid the need for what has been required and been necessary in Wales to provide a pause. I'll bring in Will Tyler-Greg in terms of the direct communications that there have been with local authorities on this.
Thank you, Minister. I would say that a lot of this programme is data driven, and we understand, for example, how many properties are being entered onto the national matching service system, and so we can encourage pace around that. And the Minister has talked about the investment that's been made to encourage local authorities to use sort of innovative approaches to get more properties onto the system more quickly. And then the middle bit is the matching. And we, again, share all data back with COSLA, and COSLA talks to us regularly about the actions that it thinks that it could take to speed up the pace of matching. Matching in itself is not a clerical kind of one in, one out. The Minister's alluded to the fact that a lot of that is human relationships and human driven. And so people may have preferences and will voice choice, and that is taken into account as part of that. So we know the That's the performance that we need to hit on the National Matching Service. COSLA is around the table on those discussions, and so the actions that they have given to the committee in returning evidence, I would expect to be of no surprise, and we are working very hard to make that happen. In terms of funding, we have not received any funding from the UK government. We have, however, issued letters of assurance to all councils to explain how the UK government funding system is, as we understand it, supposed to work. And I have also heard, just before coming into committee, that all councils have claim forms now, UK government claim forms, for thank you payments and tariff payments. But I'd be very happy to pick that up directly with the Highland Council after the meeting today.
I hope that provides further clarity, particularly around the funding issue, which I was articulating and Mr. Tyler Gregg has provided further expansion on. The fact that local authorities are only now just getting those claim forms, and the fact that we've had to provide letters of comfort, particularly around the £200 payment, serves to highlight the challenges that we've had in terms of confirming and knowing what's going to be happening from a UK funding perspective. We're working very closely with UK government ministers. The relationship in that regard is positive, but there are often challenging conversations about ensuring that the rhetoric is matched with action, and that's very, I think we need to make sure that there is greater pace inserted into getting the funding scenario resolved, because I think that is at least part of the concern that local government have.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Yes, thank you, Convener. It was just for a very small supplementary on the comments made by Mark Ruskell about access to buses. The COSLA paper we have has actually got statistics on the number of people who are already in Scotland from other asylum and humanitarian schemes, and it was just a human touch that when I met Ukrainian people who'd come to Scotland last week, one of them told me that in Ukraine the cost of a bus trip is 10p if you translate it to Scottish money. So I thought that was, it's a cultural and a financial gap for them that is, I think, making people quite anxious.
I can perfectly understand that, and you know, the people from that arriving from Ukraine, many, most of them, their lives have been turned upside down. Their property is, you know, has often been destroyed. Their resources have, their finances have been ripped apart, either to get here in the first place. You know, huge challenges that they're facing. Clearly, we're wanting to do everything that we can to provide the support that's required to allow them to re-establish their lives. And transport is one element. There are many others that we are investing in to ensure that we are doing everything possible to ensure that they're able to re-establish their lives here in Scotland for as long as they want to call Scotland their home.
A couple of final questions, Minister, if that's okay. It's something Mr. Mankowski mentioned earlier, was access to nursery placements. Now, he mentioned it being access to free places over three, but of course the legislation in Scotland is for vulnerable two-year-olds as well. And I just wondered if you'd had any conversations with local authorities about assessing children who are from the displaced community here to ensure that any vulnerable two-year-olds are also getting that free nursery education.
Yeah, I mean, given all the challenges that we've already set out that for local government, I put it in this context, but I would say that we're working in partnership with local government on these issues, and I would ask that local authorities, both in the question around access to childcare, but also in the question that Mr. Mankowski posed around school catchment areas, use the flexibility and discretion that they have to their absolute maximum to make people's arrival in Scotland as warm and supportive and understanding as possible.
And finally, it was my opening question to the Consul General. It was about the when there's a breakdown in placement, about people going onto social media seeking a new sponsor and possibly exposing them as a vulnerable family in that context. What reassurance can you give to people who face those situations that the Scottish Government is there to step in and that support is available without having to go through sort of those kind of social media outlets.
I'm very grateful to you, Convener, for sending that particular case to me, and also asking this question today, because it gives me the opportunity to once again say, in no uncertain terms, that nobody in Scotland needs to use social media to find private matches. That is the whole point of the super sponsor scheme. It makes it safer. We don't need people running the risk of well-meaning social media pages that are offering rematching or matching services. That is not needed in Scotland. The Scottish Government will match you. And if a match breaks down, contact your Welcome Hub, contact your local resettlement team, contact the Scottish Government, contact your MSP, anyone, but you do not need to go through social media sites. There are major safeguarding concerns that I have. I've articulated these to UK ministers around the prevalence of them elsewhere in the UK and about how that is posing a major risk to the Homes for Ukraine scheme elsewhere. And I cannot stress highly enough how people should not be using social media to try to find private matches. It's not necessary in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Minister, and to your officials for your attendance this morning. We are now moving into private session, but we do have a final agenda item, so if people could clear the room, that would be very helpful. Thank you.